So I was just, for those online, I was just kind of going through a quick summary of the overview of what's in this ordinance and starting to go through each section. So I'll just back up one real quick. Again, it was a purpose statement to start it out with, talking about wind and solar and energy storage systems or battery farms. And then I was just getting into state law here. So with wind energy systems and solar, just as a general rule, these larger projects that we're starting to see proposed by the large companies that are generating energy for distribution to the grid. So it's not a farm that's putting it up for their own use. It's not a homeowner doing that. It would be for the larger projects that cover acres and acres of land. The state has basically said that they are going to be the authority when it gets to be over a certain point or a certain size. So 5,000 kilowatts or 5 megawatts would be kind of where it starts, where the state takes over control of that. And then they say, you know, if the state is issuing the permits, it's not really anything that the local governments can address directly anyways. But there is that section at the bottom here, 216F, that talks about for wind standards that the commission, meaning the Public Utilities Commission at the state level, when they're considering permit applications for these large wind energy conversion systems, in a county that has its own standards, they have to consider those standards, and if they're reasonable, implement those. So that's really the reason for why Stevens County would want to have its own ordinance, even though the state is actually doing the permitting in these cases. Similar with solar, where in that case it has to be 50 megawatts or 50,000 kilowatts or more before the state would become the authority. So you'll see a lot more solar projects coming to you than you would necessarily wind, at least based on the trends today. And again, it has that language about kind of preempting the local government from issuing permits. It's more of a state project. So the state project does have a process for involving public comment, either from the county itself or from public citizens. But just to want to give that a little background to some of these projects and how that permitting works. So this is a summary that was given in a presentation by the state agency that deals with these, just to kind of summarize that. So 5 megawatts and below, the county would be the permitting authority for wind energy. Above that, it's the Public Utilities Commission. And then between 5 and 25 megawatts, counties can request or ask to be the permitting authority. So there is some authority to go up the scale there and have the county be the permitting authority. And then solar, it's below 50 megawatts county, and above 50 megawatts, it would be the PUC. So the types of projects regulated by this for wind, it's kind of broken down into four categories. There's the micro WECs, which would be just kind of the towers that are shorter and used primarily just for one property. So that's 5 kilowatts or less. And 40-foot tall towers or less. And so those kinds of projects are much less regulated, certainly not by the state, and much less regulated by the county in terms of what kind of requirements are made. So they're allowed for, they do have to meet some certain requirements still, but not overly regulated too much. And then there's the non-commercial WECs. They're a little bit larger. So these would be less than 100 kilowatts. So this would be more the scale of your individual home, or maybe a larger farm or a commercial business might have something like this. And so those would be 100 kilowatts or less, smaller heights, less than 200 feet tall. Commercial WECs would be the ones that we're seeing more proposals for now, where these would be the large ones across multiple sections, multiple counties. And those would be the larger ones over 200 feet in height. Some of those are getting to be quite a bit more than 200 feet, more like 600 or 700 feet in height total. And then the MET towers, meteorological towers, are the temporary towers that they put up to kind of measure wind speeds and kind of see where they think it makes the most sense to put wind towers. So they'll be most efficient. So all four of those are regulated by this ordinance in some fashion or another. Similar with solar, there's the accessory use solar, which would again be primarily for somebody's house. Just on their own. So those are the pretty small ones that go on a rooftop or maybe in a yard. There's the small solar energy systems that would be 40 kilowatts or less. It's a little bit larger, but primarily still for single properties, with a little bit being sold back to the grid potentially. And then there's the large ones, which would be the ones that are 40 acres, 100 acres, whatever would be a solar farm is typically what those are called. So all three of those are regulated by this ordinance. And then there's the energy storage systems, which would be these kind of battery farms. And those are just a number of different ways. And that's kind of a changing technologies and changing field here of how those are going in. But lithium ion batteries kind of tend to be the current way of doing it. There's some different other types of batteries that are being looked at now too. And so this would regulate those because those are often part of a project for storing the energy so that it can be distributed to the grid as it's needed rather than having to use it right away. So then there's a section on permitted locations. I realize this is a little bit hard to read, but it just kind of talks about each of those four categories across the top. So this is the wind one. So it talks about the micro WECs. So WECs, when I use that phrase, that's wind energy conversion system. So micro WECs, non-commercial WECs, commercial, and then the Met Towers. So for instance, the micro WECs would be permitted in most places except shoreland. Non-commercial gets permitted in a few places, and then the I in those tables becomes an interim use, meaning it's allowed for a certain period of time and then they have to renew it. And so that just kind of lays out real generally where they would be allowed or not. So generally they're not allowed in shoreland areas, which is 1,000 feet from lakes, 300 feet from rivers that are protected by the DNR. Some other areas where they're not allowed as well. Application requirements for wind. So I'll just start out by saying that if you have a smaller wind project just for your house, these application requirements are going to be pretty simple for yours. It's not going to include all of these things that are up here on the screen. It'll be your name, kind of a general description of the project, but not too much more than that. You'll still have some requirements to meet, you know, meeting electrical codes and different things like that. But this list is primarily more for those large commercial projects. So there's different things in there about with wind towers. We want kind of a signed copy of the power purchase agreement from the utility that's going to purchase this energy, just to make sure that it's legitimately going to be used and it's not just going to be constructed and sit there with nobody buying it. Flicker analysis, which is kind of that shadow flicker that comes with wind tower blades circling around. Ice throw that can come from the ice freezing on the blades and being thrown in some cases. Issues about blade failure, emergency response, so making sure that your local emergency response officials are aware of what's going on and what needs to be done if something were to happen with one of these towers. Just some other things about how it impacts potentially radio waves or microwaves for emergency communications and other things, cell towers and that. So there's a number of things that are through this. I won't go through all of them in detail. We can talk about them in the question and answer section, but quite a bit here about how we want to do that. And then, of course, seeing what their plan is for decommissioning. So when this reaches the end life of its useful life, which could be 20 to 30 years, generally is what we're hearing these days, that they have a plan for doing that. And then when we move to setbacks, there's different setback requirements for the wind towers that we proposed here. And again, realize you can't see this too well, but if you've looked it over ahead of time, you can kind of see what those are. Just as an example, from property boundaries, there would be an expectation that these towers would be at least 3 rotor diameters. So when you take the length of a individual blade, multiply that by 3, that would be your setback from property lines on the non-prevailing wind direction. So most of the wind comes through a certain direction. That's the prevailing wind direction. You would have a 5 rotor diameter setback, or 4, I'm sorry, from that, 4 to 5. And then it would be a little bit less on the less prevailing wind side. And that's primarily about protecting the wind rights of their neighboring property for them to put up their own tower if they want, because there is some impact on the wind from these towers being there. And then there's setbacks from dwellings, either on the property itself that the tower's already on, or on neighboring dwellings. And so that would come into play. Road rights of way, There will be setbacks from that, primarily to protect against ice throw going onto the road and onto passenger vehicles that are going along the road. We have city boundary setbacks. Right now, we've had a number of discussions about this, what the right number should be, but what we have in the draft is 2 miles from cities that have a population of 2,500 or greater, which would basically be Morris in this case, and then 1 mile from smaller cities. So that's something that can be discussed, and all these things are certainly open for discussion and change. And then when we move on to solar, again, the same thing about a chart about where they're permitted or interim uses or where they are just not allowed at all. Again, solar application requirements that will be fairly simple for people that just want them for their homes or their farms, but a little bit more demanding in terms of what we're looking for in terms of the large commercial projects. So again, basic information about what you're trying to do on the site, the layout of things, those kinds of issues. And then setbacks for solar, which would be generally quite a bit less than what it would be for wind towers from property lines and dwellings. But there are still setback requirements in there. And then these energy storage systems or battery farms, they would all require an interim use permit no matter where they are. The proposed setbacks would be kind of listed out there, quarter mile from neighboring dwellings, 200 feet from streams and ditches, 100 feet from right-of-ways, and quarter mile from other property lines. Cities would have a 2 mile setback in the draft, not allowed in shoreland areas. So the primary issue with these can be noise potentially from the cooling fans that go with some of them, and then also the potential for somewhat rare, but could happen with fires and dealing with that. And we just generally, for all these kinds of projects, we have some general standards that apply to all of them. Things in there for screening them from view as best we can, either with vegetation or fencing or something else. Noise issues, glare for solar panels, potentially stormwater management, again, with solar. Waste disposal, if they're repairing them or they're damaged by hailstorms or whatever it might be, how that handles has happened. And again, notification and education of local emergency personnel so that they're aware of how to deal with issues that might come up. And then for decommissioning, again, they have to submit a plan for that. They have to put up some form of financial security so that if they were to just walk away from the project for some reason, the county would have the money in place to decommission it itself or hire somebody to do that. So there's a number of options that are given in there that are kind of traditional financial securities and ordinances like this, either a bond or a letter of credit, or kind of what the preferred method is so far when the county has talked about this is an escrow where they actually put cash into the county's coffers, so to speak, and it's held there for this purpose only. And those some requirements for that. Requirement that they disassemble these things rather than demolishing them. So you might have seen some things where wind towers in particular are just kind of collapsed and crash onto the ground, and that's how they take care of those. And so this one would require that they disassemble them to reduce the kind of waste and pieces that would get maybe not picked up when they're cleaning things up. Removal of any infrastructure that they've put in for the soil restoration if it's a farm site that needs to go back to crop farming. And then a final decommissioning report requirement that they need to submit to show that they've done everything that they were supposed to do. And then kind of lastly here, towards the end, the public infrastructure. So these, when these go in, there's a lot of heavy truck traffic, obviously moving things in and out. There's some need for upgrading of some of these gravel township roads or county roads that we have at times. Sometimes they have to put in, especially with the wind towers, they have to get bigger turning radiuses for the blades that are so long. So they have to put in like temporary widened driveways and that kind of thing. And then again, providing a financial security in case these things aren't taken care of the right way. The county has the money to do that. So that's kind of the summary here for that. If you do want more information, Rebecca Young here is county administrator, is kind of the main contact for that. I'm available to help too as I can, but that's kind of the basics.
Thank you, Ben. Appreciate it. And now, open the hearing for public testimony. Again, please come up to the microphone, raise your hand, and come online, whatever you want, but name and address, please.
Someone's got to be first, right? Paul Daly, I'm 16485 Allen and Donnelly. And I want to thank you guys for working on updating this wind and solar ordinance. It's a difficult task, and dealing with up to a 57-year contract with a small percentage of landlords in the county are signing with 700-foot turbines proposed that who knows how big they'll be for sure. And that really never been built anywhere else before. There's three generations of little decisions made in the ordinance that we come up with. Now, when Ben was going over the ordinance here, and we went over the 3x5 rotor diameter for participating in the 4-rotor, you didn't really touch on the 4-rotor diameter for non-participating in the 5. In that ordinance, it appears it's stated as diameter, its axis diameter, and it's a very confusing thing. And Ben, now today, the last meeting I was at, it appeared like you guys thought you had a 2,000 and a 2,500-foot setback from non-participating in property lines. And as Ben stated, it's axis, so it's actually the radius. It's only half of that. It splits in the middle and goes off from there. And that's what you were saying, right, Ben? It's the measurement on the blade going one direction.
Okay, so yeah, that is a little confusing. The rotor diameter, I guess the way that I would interpret that, and I think it's defined in the ordinance too, a little bit clearly too, but it's the diameter, so the full sweep of the blades. If you measure all the way across that would be the diameter of it, of the sweep. And so then it would be 4 times that or 3 times that, whatever the number is. So
when you put the word axis in there, I'm pretty sure, and you need that, the way I understand it, it's radius as it shows in that picture.
Yeah, the intent would be for it to be that full diameter or sweep of the blade.
So it
goes around.
So what is your interpretation of that distance?
Well,
if you go to what you went over, the 3-rotor diameter on a secondary wind axis, what is that to you? That's 500 on a 500-foot rotor diameter.
So if the blade, one single blade coming out from the center of the tower was, just as an example, say 200 feet long, the diameter then would be 400 feet, twice that. And so then you would take that 400 feet times 3 or 4 or 5 or whatever the number is. So if it was 400 feet times 500 diameters, that would be 2,000 feet. So
I don't want to be correct on that. What's the word axis in there? It's going from the center. So I think you actually have 250 times 3 that goes east and 250 times 3 that goes west. So you'd have 750, is my understanding of this. I just want to make sure that everybody's clear on this and that we have this right and we're all understanding it the same.
Because certainly make sure that's,
because either it's 700 feet or it's 1500 feet on the participating, and on the non-participating, which I'm more concerned about, is either 2,000 feet or 1,000 feet secondary wind access. Or 2,500 or 1,250 secondary wind. And the way I'm understanding it, it's going to be the 1,250 and the 1,000. So we want to make sure that that is the way that we're. So what I gather right now is you are thinking that on the non-participating, it's a 2,000-foot setback on the non-primary wind. And it's a 2,500 on the primary.
And if you have that draft, there's a definition for rotor diameter.
Yep.
It says the diameter of the circle described by the moving rotor blades. So that's kind of what I was referring to.
Right. Well, but I believe that the term access in there changes that. And that's what I want to make sure is everybody is clear on, especially the property owner in the living room.
And we can research that. That's why we're here.
Yeah, so that's one point. That would be great.
Yeah, we'll get back to you. And,
okay.
And let you know.
All right. It's very important to make these setbacks fit what's possibly coming, as no one's quality of life and property value should be destroyed by neighboring property owner's decision. There's many examples out there when you start researching this. A couple of houses in Colorado was selling for 50-80% under appraised value because of health issues caused by shallow flicker and noise. Farm site in Iowa deemed unlivable after it was surrounded by turbines. And there's many more examples of this. These 700-foot towers will cause shadow flicker up to a mile and a half in noise for the same distance when the conditions are right. What will the true cost be for the people of Stevens County? Yeah, we don't really know that. The landscape is definitely going to change. My turn for it is landscape pollution, but we got the ice throw danger, we got the property value, quality of life destruction, we have unreliable and expensive power coming online. If construction starts, initially road damage and road building and widening the haul of massive equipment in, along with tower building, this will use up our limited and valuable gravel resources. What will the cost of gravel be once we have none or very little? The townships and colonies just for maintaining roads. Along with any resident looking to build bins, buildings, houses, etc. in the future. Decommissioning is another thing that concerns me in the draft. These things, it's showing that your preferred method is an escrow. And to me, that should be the only method, just because if the cash isn't there, then say, who's responsible for it after your company filed bankruptcy? If subsidies are full and either the solar or wind work anymore and these companies walk away or whatever happens, then who's responsible for it? If the cash isn't there, who's going to pay for it? It certainly shouldn't be the county. And as I stated earlier, this is, we're trying to figure this out for three generations. So, you know, it's not going to be us worrying about it. It's going to be our kids and grandkids that are going to have to do that. So I'm just going to encourage you to use the escrow of decommissioning. And then there's plenty of, like the Grand Meadow, Minnesota, where they got 100 blades laying on the edge of town. You know, that thing has happened because of a bankruptcy and now nobody claims ownership of them. You've made some good strides in this process, and let's make this fit the whole population of this county as we move forward. Thank you.
Mike Reese, 24544, Danny Nathan. So, first of all, I'd like to offer to commend you, Mr. Chair, and the division members. I think you've done a fair and balanced job in putting this together. I think there's some technical things that could be improved, so I'd like to discuss that. But first, I'll address the access to the executive mountain. That's actually referring to the wind roll of access, but an access of either northwest, southeast, or southwest, northeast. That would refer to a wind turbine in that particular context. So I think what you had said here is the definition.
Thank you.
Can you hear me?
No.
Yeah. Okay, so the definition you have is correct. So I would start by saying wind energy is one of the cheapest sources of energy, period, right now. It's about 2 to 3 cents a kilowatt hour for utilities. You're not going to find that in nuclear, coal, or natural gas. And that's why utilities are moving in this direction. That's why we have wind developers in this area. And Stevens County has always been a pro business county. And I would kind of contend that. There is benefits for all because the benefits flow down through production tax or the taxes that are charged to our county, our schools, our townships and other services. So that's why we have right now, why we have such good community services and hospitals, schools, also support their churches. So there is a broad benefit here. I want to point that out. And then for the long term, you know, we also have to keep our environment in mind, whether we agree or not that climate change, a lot of the people that purchase our products and General Mills, Target, they're all looking to reduce their carbon intensity. That's coming back to farmers, so we need to start keep making locals. So to the technical changes, I heard suggestions I have from the commission. Commissioners, first of all, I think you need to define native prairie. It's just a native prairie. If you want to have this as land that has never been cultivated for crops or for pasture, I think you need to define utility scale battery. I think it's pretty wide open. Actually, take a little bit of issue with the term battery farm. I don't know if the example actually, maybe one of them, some of them qualifies as a battery farm. Most of these are going to be very small in nature. So maybe one or two utility boxes, or I should say, Connex boxes. So I would ask you to revisit battery and energy storage in general. And we have capacitors right now in the city that may not fit your definition. And we possibly have electric vehicles that are going for light use 100 kilowatt hours of energy storage for driving down the road. So I think you really need to take a look and get some better definitions in that format. And I won't be afraid of battery storage. You hear a lot about battery fires, but those are very rare. And there's actually more dangers in gas stations, LP tanks, natural gas to our homes. So I think that needs a lot more work. And some of the world leaders here at the UMM campus in that area, so we need to visit them specifically about this. Because I think batteries will be coming, and the technology will be improving, and I think we should pay special attention to that. I'd like to talk a little bit about 40 kW from a solar system size that's very small. I've already mentioned plenty of pickup is 181 kilowatts. We're talking about a very small system, and you're calling anything over 40 kW a large solar system. I think you should expand that up to at least 100. We're going to be, there's scenarios where, for example, a rural residence area, the residents could go together and have a 100 kW or 120 kW or 200 kW solar system that serves the whole rural residence. Right now, that's not allowed. So I think that should be changed to enter a use where you can visit that on a case-by-case basis. And then just the final comments on the EPA requirements. You know, we're at the cutting edge of some of this work that's being done on wind and solar. And I don't think a PPA really matters for a county. I mean, don't ask a swine producer or dairy producer that show them you their contracts before building these facilities. Why should you do the same with wind and solar? PPA is just a contract between utility. But if I want to use the wind or the solar system myself, I will not have a PPA. So I won't be allowed to build essentially like that. So just a few things to take in mind. Again, thank you for your work on this. Really important. And I do seem to me that it doesn't favor one side or the other, that it's really fair and balanced. So thank you for your work.
In 14670600 in Chicago. October 15, 2015, an accident that caused transcranial group caused me to be after 1 year. Plus the any other hits I get after back to me. One problem I want solved is, are we going to have a setback distance at least 2,000 feet or more? My TBI makes it sound sensitive to flashing lights, loud, continuous noises, and long arm around when the brain wears down after later sit down for hours. If I'm tired, I wear specialists and the noise reducer, headphones, and other passive problems like the function part of my daily life. I found my travels when there is wind powers too close to roads, I can't look at them when they're turning. It activates my TBI symptoms when I'm traveling in southwest Minnesota. The night symptoms are worse. When I'm standing up just watching flashing lights that are close to proximity, I get a headache from standing down instead of the work right, I have to be touching something the ground. Okay, can I do it now? Only way I can stop this problem is not look at them, period. I'm not against wind towers, but there needs to be setback distances that don't affect people like me with disabilities. I'm not the only person in this county that has TBI problems. So I want to set back just as far as I can. So when I look out my barn door, I can look out at it and not have to go lay down or change direction or anything else. And if I'm surrounded by it, I would die. I'll have to move. So I'm saying, yeah, set back just as far as I can. Respect the people that live on the barns themselves. I've lived here since 1961. And I was here in Stevens County. So please get setback distances far away from the farm settings, please. Thank you.
My name is Susan Shalar. My address is 23075 167 of the North Minnesota. And my purpose being here is just to make the commissioners aware the last meeting I listened to back in July from the commissioner, there were a couple of people that said that they had no idea about the ice throw for ice shedding. So I'm just here to say that my husband and I, we walked on a gravel road and from the Smart City Park up to having 329. And there's a generator there, and we've seen the ice laying on the skin of snow from the waves. I'm assuming, I'm not for sure that it's paved, but it's in an open area with ice. It looks like the ice is mopped on place on the generator. And there's a sign posted on the chain link fence that's right next to the generator that says caution, ice can fall from the face or something to that effect. So just want to make you aware that that is something that's going to happen. So I'm just going to do it again. Thank you.
As we visited earlier, and I still see has been placed in the ordinances. A couple things that come to mind is they got ISO analysts in here. Who's paying the bill on that? Is that going to be the county that's going to have to hire these, or are we going to hire the turbine companies to pay the bill? Wondering if we can go back. The GE already did a study in 2006. It had 1.5 times total height plus rotor diameter. That will at least factor, depending on how big these things actually get, or if they change sizes. I think that would help either that or. I think it was being brought up that it was a 4 times rotor diameter away from all roads regulars at the work session, which apparently didn't get printed. Along with that, I also am a member of Chicago community. I see your 2 mile setback got removed. That I think that was asked for at your last meeting. I know it's down to a 1 mile. I'm kind of curious on why that is.
Mr. Chair, can I take that question really quick? Because I think that's come up. We did a survey and it was inconclusive amongst small cities about what the setback is. So that's a decision point for the board to make. The board had indicated 2 miles, but there was some differentiation between small cities. So that is a decision point that the board needs to make. I think that discussion and review of statute, the greatest you could go would be 2 miles. That's a generally held long arm reach of the city for subdivision planning. And our guidance as staff is that's a policy decision you guys are going to have to make because it wasn't conclusive for the desired setback among small cities. So that was a topic that they needed to discuss tonight and give some guidance on.
Thank you both for You know, I'm going to just say it this way. I heard at one point in time that the development for a small community probably isn't as great as a bigger community. But if the things are already in place at a 2 mile setback, people will have the right to build their homes where they want. If they see the shadow flicker, the noise, they're going to move. They're not going to build in the sight of these things, in my opinion. And besides that, I believe the fire danger. That's another thing that most people don't bring up because it's a mechanical operation. It's got oil, it's got bearings. I've seen them on fire. But so that's the two things. And I just want to make another comment quickly. I got a article here about America wind and solar prices soaring, making them the most expensive electricity in Minnesota. So if anybody wants to read that, here it is. Thank you.
I'd also like to thank the board for their work on this. I was one of the ones who went to the first meeting asking that you address it. Recent years, there's been a green movement in the Morris area of Stevens County. In my mind, when I think of a green movement, I think of an attempt to improve the quality of life in an area, say Stevens County or the Morris area. Improving the quality of life in our county shouldn't just be a feel-good thing. It should be about creating a good ordinance that also protects the safety and ability of our residents to enjoy living here in the rural townships as well as the cities and towns. It would seem hypocritical to promote our area as green and a great place to live if we're going to do this in a way that jeopardizes the safety and quality of life of some residents by placing wind turbines that are possibly the largest ever constructed in the U.S. too near to roadways and homes. If we allow turbines to be built too near the roadways or ice thrown from the blades during certain weather conditions could potentially kill or injure people, we're asking them to play a dangerous game of Russian roulette. The placement of these turbines is going to affect our area for the 30 to 50 year lifespan of the structures. And it isn't just ice throw, there's shadow flicker and noise that have been mentioned by other people that have negatively affected people's ability to enjoy living in their own homes. So the board has the important responsibility to look beyond the dollar signs of possible revenues to their county townships and a select few landowners. Let's write an ordinance that errs inside of caution and keeps Stevens County a great place to live and a safe place to raise our families for the next generation. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Brian Herman, 17788 457th Avenue, Morris, Minnesota. Again, as others have said, I appreciate the work on this. I do have some technical things that I would really like you to consider. On the solar systems, you might have already mentioned this, but the 40 kW is very small. I have solar panels on my house right now. If I were to replace them, it would actually not be enough, because panels are more productive. So a small number of panels are more productive, but if I replace the exact panels I have right now, I would not be able to do that. So I think you need to think about 180 or 100. The array that we have at the university that is along the highway is 500. You can see the size of it. So if you think a lot smaller than that, you could think, give them a little bit. And I also don't rural residents, so that's why I would be a lead. So I would ask you to think about that. The other piece is the battery part. You have defined as 100 kW, or excuse me, 100. That is very, very small. And I think what you will see, I understand what you're trying to protect against is a large battery farm. In the research that we've done, what we've seen, there's going to be lots of small batteries around, and I don't think you want to avoid that opportunity for people to have that benefit, both from an economic standpoint and the on campus. We have a small battery that is in one container. One container is 100 kW. So I think you need to think about the sizing of it. I would be glad to show you around and demonstrate that to you. We at the university, we've had lots of opportunity to be part of where battery storage is going. It's very safe. And people will go beyond the lithium ion piece that you're talking about. And so I want you to think about what you're writing here could affect 10 years from now. We want to make sure that we have the right thing. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Brendan. I'm on Park Avenue here in West. I have some handouts as well for folks. If you want to take those in. Basically, what I'd like to do is I'd like to commend you guys for working hard on this ordinance for wind, solar, and battery storage. I just wanted to give a couple scoping comments that reflect some discussion we've been having. So, first of all, I think everyone needs to know that the University of Minnesota has two turbines in Morris. One is 70 meters and one is 80 meters. Underneath one of the turbines are some of the most studied cows in Minnesota. Each of these turbines is 1.65 megawatts, and they make about 5 million. Kilowatt hours per year. Keeping in mind, 1 meter is about 1 yard, and 1 yard is about 3 feet. So you can multiply meters by 3 to get feet. The U.S. Geological Survey has a great wind map tool. I know these guys have been discussing 5 megawatt wind turbines, or at least that's what I'm trying to get from the public record. So 2 Saturdays ago, I drove to Orkley, South Dakota, to Summit, South Dakota, to basically stand underneath 5 megawatt wind turbines. I assume you guys have done the same or visited the Morris turbines, but they're just close to here. So you can just drive over to Orkley and look at them yourself. Xcel Energy has basically done 3 projects there, essentially Dakota Range 1 and 2 and Dakota Range 3. The Dakota Range 3 turbines are 4.8 megawatts, essentially 5 megawatt wind turbines. It is the first project with 72 turbines. Dakota Range 3 was 29 turbines, so about 100 turbines in total. Keep in mind, Otter Tail Power, we're going to build a $1.6 billion coal-fired power plant just back in 2009 and pulled out of the project. Baystone 1 on the way to the Coteau is 450 megawatt. So they installed about the equivalent amount of wind power at the coal plant. Keep in mind that in just an estimate, a 5 megawatt wind turbine makes about 17 million kilowatt hour per year. 17 million kilowatt hour is 17,000 megawatt hour. And as you know, there's a production tax credit of 36 cents per megawatt hour in Minnesota. 80% of that goes to the county, 20% goes back to the city. 17,000 megawatt times 36 cents is $6,120. So you should be thinking about $6,120 goes per turn, like this income per turn. And each turbine takes is less than an acre. If you look at the paper I gave you, you can see some pictures I took from my adventure to Orkley. You can see how small the footprint is. So you can imagine that even if a turbine did take an acre, and we did the same project that they did in South Dakota, that'd be 100 acres. Keep in mind, in Stevens County, there are 360,000 acres in the county, and 330,000 acres are in farmland. So basically, if we did the same thing here, about 0.03% of the acres would be like be taken up. We did the same project here, about 0.03% of our acres being farmland. Of course, and I know that's a concern, it's how many acres are we taking out of the farmland? We'd be taking 0.03% out. Now, that doesn't include that some of the land is leased. And I gave you numbers on this sheet about how many acres were leased for these projects. But just the Dakota one and two project powers 160,000 homes. To wrap up here, I just mentioned that as I said, each turbine makes about 17 million kilowatt hours at 5 megawatt. And the production tax credit will be taking about 1% of what it makes per year. So that's what we'll be taking. And I also have a sheet on there that talks about everything's a little bit more complicated. But basically, if we have the same project in Stevens County making about 1.4 million megawatt hours per year that bring in about $1.6 million in tax revenues. So obviously, this is also a big economic decision. I was at one of your work planning sessions where you were talking about how funding for lawyering, legal representation for accused kids in the county was a challenge. And I was sitting there thinking, you know, here we have a major opportunity for economic development in the county. Obviously, clean energy development, hydrogen development, ammonia development, the backbone of this development is going to be powered by renewables. So thanks for the consideration. And if you have questions, I'd be happy to, at some point, to talk more about what I saw in Berkeley. But as part of this, thank you.
Anyone else? This is a good time to state your opinion here. What it's for. Oh, we talked somebody in. No.
My name is Doug Reed. I live at 311 West 7th Street. This was possibly this is my house. We made ready to go. We met before we don't get anybody. Here in Morris. I lead a program at the university called the Morris Challenge. So we bring high school students to the university and the West Central Research and Outreach Center to show them the renewable energy work and sustainability work that we've done here on campus and out of Rock. One of the things we talk to the kids about is, and I didn't know this, I grew up in Illinois. My dad, when I was a kid, was a coal miner. He also grew a coal truck for the power plant in Springfield. So Illinois has energy. Minnesota doesn't have any coal in the ground. We don't have any natural gas in the ground. We don't have any petroleum reserves. So what we do have in abundance is wind energy. We also have solar energy in abundance. And we also have the ability to store that with some of the battery technology that's coming online. So the reason I mentioned the program for high school is we talk about the economic development opportunities that will come from renewable energy and other technologies coming online. So I just bring those things up to encourage you to think about those because to Troy's point, tax revenues are important, jobs are important. And those things, you have the potential to not only participate in the energy economy, which our primary participation up to this point has been with corn and ethanol, where you have the opportunity to lead in terms of those other areas. So that's all I have. Thanks.
Any other questions? I want to make sure everybody has a chance. If not, we got it. You made them all a little bit. Thank you.
So, KL 3359015005. More for the talk has been about winding persons who are going, but I think. They are set back there, but I think the setbacks we go over is too close to major housing or whatever. And that should be a little further to get respect to that person's house. They don't have to do that. This is full time. Thank you.
Any other questions? If not, I will now hold the public hearing and reconvene the planning commission. I'm going to ask for any discussion from the board here. Do you have any comments? Let me know.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Just a couple of follow-up comments. There's a few things we had discussed to staff. Let me grab my notes here. And Bill or Ben, feel free to hop in here. When the discussion was about the escrow and some of those items in the ordinance, I had asked Ben a few questions as our consultant to see some of the feedback. We do have some language that we could strengthen in there that essentially would say that the preferred method, not that the preferred method, but that the method would be escrow unless specifically agreed to by the board for a different method, so that the default would be an escrow. The petitioning party would have to ask the board to present some other sort of financial security. So that's one item that we could potentially add in there. That kind of led me to think about a couple other questions. And one of the ones I had was like transfer of ownership. And I think in terms of some of these projects, maybe not the current one being proposed here in Stevens County, but we do see transfer of ownership of some of these assets over their life. And so the question was to consultant, you know, does this, it's kind of implied that it would transfer, the escrow agreement would transfer those contracts as they assume a business. But I think the board could potentially modify that language to specifically call out that escrow agreements and all those things shall transfer instead of just have it implied. So you could strengthen your position with some of that language there if the board desired to. Let me just bring up one more thing here. Some of the questions too were about the ice throw, and you know, it's ordered in there as a part of that interim use for large scale projects, that there would be this independent study, or that there'd be a study done for some of these things. My question was, you know, could the board potentially through the ordinance ordain an independence of parties for those studies? I think that would probably be maybe to your benefit to potentially consider, you know, putting some language in there about that the party that provides the evidence must have independence of parties from the one that's petitioning for the interim use permit. And then another question was, you know, we have this other rights away. We've called out recreational trails, power lines, easements, et cetera. And the question came from somebody in the public, you know, could we put add pipelines to that list? So that would be, you know, it does say et cetera, but we do know that we have the presence of pipelines. So it would probably behoove you to consider maybe adding that as an amendment. Let me just look at my list here of notes. We will do some more looking at that description and that access and talk some amongst staff. I don't know if Senator Bill have anything they want to comment on that, but I do have one more follow-up here. And then I think the question was asked in the public, who pays for the bill of those studies? And generally speaking, and Bill's a better person to answer this, but during the interim use process, when there's a petitioner to the Planning Commission, all costs associated with their petition, advertising, studies that are ordered are borne by the petitioning party. That's the way that our concurrent interim use and conditional use work, is that all those costs are to the petitioning party. And then the other piece was just to follow up again on that setback. We did have inconclusive guidance through surveying, just through, you know, general surveys about what small cities desired, and specifically we're speaking those under 2500. So the board does need to make a decision on that. That's a decision point for you to give guidance to staff and what you want this to be modified to. Do you want it left at 1 mile? Do you want to put it 2 miles? I do not believe there was a small city that requested more than 2 miles. In consultation with our consultant in statute, I don't believe that the board has authority to order that. I think the max that you could consider would be 2 miles. So that's just kind of some of the follow-up quick from the public hearing that I heard, and I know the board wants to have some discussion. Did Ben or Bill have anything right now that you wanted to add? We're good right now.
Okay. That's good enough. Yeah.
For Ben, could you look at this as the battery sizes? So we're not looking at it for Andrew's health, and that would be legal with what we're doing and what we do with them. I think that is something that we should address.
Basically, make sure that smaller individual homes are concerned.
At Brian's invitation to talk about that, we might even have fun coming in and give us some more background. Appreciate that. We're staff and decide what we want to keep the same and changes to our draft. And then help us fill that in. And we will have another meeting on 9/4/24 with a new draft. And if there's no question by the commission, I'd like to have a motion to.
Go ahead. Mr. Chairman and Board, and the question is probably equitable amendment. With city setback, if we leave it at a mile, the city can do their own ordinance and increase it to 2 miles. Is that correct or not?
I'll let Ben answer that. But I think I might be wrong on that. I think we can give you some clarification.
Yeah, I think that's something that we should check with the attorney or legal advice on that. But my understanding is that there's state law on top of it. Our city can impose it solely for 2 miles out, but only if the township or county doesn't have its own zoning regulations. It's case for you. So there's that part of it, and there's a couple other parts of state on top of about 2 miles distance. One is that city can impose its subdivision regulations out of our own. But again, that's sort of only if somebody else has done subdivision ordinance in that area, and then building code can go 2 miles in some cases if they're in question. But yeah, I'm not sure that the city's going to be able to get the map of how they represent that or something like this. It may, but I think it's back into that. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, one more question.
Yeah, okay.
That airport will be the deed in our ordinance?
I didn't look at that a little bit today, so it might be something that we can tell you too, but there is there's a permitting requirement for MnDOT. For the towers, there's some different numbers, and but you can check them. I think it's if it's over 500 feet tall, they start with over 500. Anywhere in the city, requires permit from MnDOT. So I'm guessing that they're located in the middle of the same right about 30 feet. So it's either the agency statement is this 200 feet or taller, and it's within 3 miles of their airport, we need this, and there's part from the rails. So there's permitted requirements from the state. I don't think it was intended to set back to meet our port needs on your own. So it's certainly something to assess, but just to be aware of it, that doesn't require any questions.
Any other questions?
To answer Joel Peel's question about the solar setback, the original solar setback from a non-participating residents was 200 feet and we raised it to 500. We really don't know because we've never really, this is all new to us too. So, but we did raise that to 500 versus 200. And then another comment on the brought up about the roads on page 28 of their ordinance. It talks about how we protect the roads and the agreements that have to be done with the construction company for repair of the road. And I believe our highway engineer will take care of that for us. And I believe the townships will be working with the county engineer to make sure that gets done properly.
And we don't have to say they've been through this before. That's not people in the wind are. Sometimes they have to be a road into a 10-ton road, and when you leave, you've got a 10-ton road. So. But they know that they've got to be put back where they are. So. Any other questions from the commission?
Mr. Chair, I want the motion to continue the hearing on September 4th at 6:30. Place can be determined or
here.
Okay, thank you.
Matt, second. Any discussion? Here you come. Call a question. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Same sign. Motion carried. Thank you all for coming. Appreciate it. We need your input.
Thank you. I have none, Mr. Chair.
Okay, motion in a second. Approve the agenda. All the favors say aye. All those opposed, motion carried. We need a motion to approve the agenda. Language in section 9, A-1 general agriculture district, allowing for the creation of parcels less than normal minimum lot size, but not used for dwellings or other uses which generate sewage. The addition of language in section 14A, sign regulations, clarifying measurements of required road setbacks for signs. The addition of language in section 14D relating to mining that clarifies the gravel pits open for borrow pits, but later used for other projects and not exempt from the regulations and other miscellaneous amendments throughout the ordinance. In order to conduct the hearing within a reasonable time, with a coupon subject to adjournment, you are asked to observe the following guidelines. Any person with a legitimate interest may present his or her view to the commission. All statements and questions must be directed to the chair. Each person making a statement will be asked to give his or her name and address. All statements are limited to 3 minutes. Please refrain from repeating what was said before you, and please do not involve personalities. He is factual as possible. The commission reserves the right to question things completely. All testimony, including maps, drawings, photos, soil information, will be made part of the hearing record. Once the public hearing is closed, in order to the testimony, may be offered, except those comments and response to the questions from the commission. I'll turn it over to Bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Can you hear me? I sent you a packet out that had the agenda, the minutes from the June 3rd Planning Commission meeting, and a memorandum that went to the county board members as well as Planning Commission members to explain the two different hearings tonight. Becky explained the first hearing very well with the renewable energy ordinance. And the reason that the Planning Commission has to meet tonight is because the county currently has a standalone wind energy ordinance, which is basically the same thing that you're looking at approving now, except you're going to incorporate the solar language from the zoning ordinance into that standalone wind energy, or better referred to as the renewable energy ordinance. So section 25 of the zoning ordinance requires any amendment has to come to the Planning Commission, and the Planning Commission has to have at least one public hearing to get testimony and make a recommendation to the county board to either approve, deny, or they can approve with changes to those recommended amendments. So that's why we are here for that. Since the solar language is being removed, the amendment, this triggered this amendment process. But as we're going through the ordinance, there's a few other cleanup items that we thought we might as well take care of as we're doing this amendment by taking the solar language out. So that's what Donnie read through when he was going through his introductory statement for the addition of a definition for agricultural structure, the addition of language for allowing the creation of parcels less than the normal lot size that's currently in there now, increasing allowable heights in the different in certain zoning districts, the addition of language in section 14 for sign, clarifying measurements of required road setbacks for signs, and the addition of language for mining that clarifies that gravel pits open for borrow pits, but later used for other projects are not exempt. So that's the amendments that we're looking at tonight. And Ben Olson of Hometown Planning has a presentation that he'll go through and give a little more definition as far as what we're talking as far as amendments here. So with that, Mr. Chair, Becky, you want to bring that? Ben's PowerPoint.
Yeah,
he knows how to.
So the good news is this shouldn't take as long as the last one. So I won't go over these again, but these are kind of the summary of things that we've been talking about that we're going to propose for being amended or changed. I'll go through them just each in turn. So that definition of agricultural structure, the reason we're looking at that is because it's used several times in the ordinance. One is to say that those kinds of structures are permitted in the ag district and shoreline districts too. It also says that they're exempted, those kinds of structures that are exempted from height requirements in the A1 district. And so that's why that's important that we kind of clarify what we mean by that. There's also a 50-foot property line setback for ag structures from properties that are zoned for residential use. And so what we needed there was an interpretation as to whether certain industrial agricultural structures are considered to have all those kinds of requirements or those exemptions. So I think everybody kind of has in mind when you say ag structure is something like a grain bin or, you know, something that's traditionally been on a farm and part of that use normally. But what we're starting to see more of is kind of industrial buildings that are used to process agricultural products or do some other activity on there that's not sort of the traditional farm. It's more of a commercial or industrial nature of it. And so we wanted to clarify what we meant by those and what wouldn't be part of that. So this black text showed up a lot better on my screen originally, so I apologize. It's not showing up the greatest here, but what it says there is that we're kind of defining what we mean by those traditional agricultural structures. So it says the new definition would say a structure on agricultural land used to store or shelter farm implements, livestock, fodder, raw or minimally processed agricultural products or other materials directly related to agricultural activity on the same or nearby properties. So that's kind of the trying to define what's traditionally been viewed as ag structures. And then the new part that would
did you refer to the page?
No, oh, yeah. It's page
12 in the
page 12 in your draft, if you got that in front of you. That's where this definition is listed. So the second part is to kind of talk about some of those more industrial or commercial structures that says building structures whose primary use is the processing, treatment, packaging, alteration, or other transformation of egg products, or whose primary use is as part of an agricultural processing plant, shall not be considered an agricultural structure for the purposes of this ordinance. So what that would mean is that it doesn't mean that they're not allowed. It just means that they're not going to be exempted from height requirements and not just permitted uses. So they would probably have to go through, or they would have to go through the way it's written, a conditional use permit process or variance if they exceeded the height that's normally allowed for structures. So that's the change that's proposed for defining those and the reason for it. The next part is to delete all the solar regulations. This is pretty straightforward. It's just wherever solar is mentioned in the zoning ordinance, it would be taken out because now it's going to be covered by this new renewable energy ordinance. And so there's no need to have it in the zoning ordinance. So there's several parts in the ordinance where there's references to solar, or there's a whole section that's dedicated to it, but in other sections where it talks about what's permitted in each zoning district, some of those things, it would have to be eliminated from there too. And then there was building height maximums. Bill can probably explain the reasoning behind all this better than I can, but I think in short, there was a thought that some of the building restrictions that we have in place now are a little bit too restrictive for modern buildings. So in the ag district, it would go from 30 foot maximum to 50. In the R1 district, it would go from 30 to 40. B1 would go from 35 to 40. And the I1 district, industrial, would go from 40 to 50. So again, ag structures are exempted from those height limits, but those more industrial or commercial ag type buildings that we're not exempting anymore would not be would be subject to these height limits or asking for a variance to go above it. And then there was an issue with people that want to split lands out in the ag district that don't necessarily need it for a dwelling. They have other uses for it or other reasons. This is page 70, he said. Page 70 in your packet. So right now what it says is that every lot that's split off in the ag district has to be 2.5 acres. It doesn't really matter whether it's intended to be used for a house or just for whatever else, some grain bins or just to attach some additional land to another property. And so the proposal is to retain that 2.5 acre minimum if it's for a dwelling. But if it's not for a dwelling, then they can go down to really any lot size they want, as long as everything still meets the applicable setbacks. So if there's any buildings, they all have to meet the setbacks to that property line. And what we would do to make sure that it's clear that that's not for a dwelling is to record a document that says that it can't be developed with a dwelling or some other building that generates sewage unless it meets that 2.5 acre minimum. So that would get recorded and be there for title searches so that people in the future would know that if they're buying that lot, it's not for a house or some other structure that has a sewage or a bathroom in it. And then the other issue with signs, this was just the current ordinance says that the setback of 10 feet is from property lines. This is page 96 of your packet. And so there's lots of situations out in the countryside where there's not an established right-of-way line or property line along a road. They're all tend to be easement roads. And so there's not really a property line per se to measure to. And so just to clarify that, we're saying that if there is no property line along the road, no right of way, then the setback would be 65 feet from the center line of the road, or the zoning administrator could determine that it's something just to, you know, enough of a distance to make sure that there's no impact on road maintenance and road activities that are out there. So that's the purpose of that one. It's not really to increase the setback. It's just to clarify what happens when there's not a property line along the road. And then the gravel pit and borrow pit regulations. This is to say right now there's language in the ordinance that says borrow pits are exempted. So these would typically be used, I believe, for like highway county road projects. It's just typically a temporary excavation of soil to be used for that project, and then it would close up. But in cases where somebody is opening up a borrow pit and then later keeps it open and wants to continue selling gravel out of it and processing gravel, then it's not really a temporary borrow pit anymore. It's just sort of a standard gravel pit that county wants to have go through its normal procedures for permitting and that. So it's just kind of clarifying how that borrow pit exemption works and where it doesn't come into play. So those, for those zoning ordinance changes, the main contact, if you had questions, would be Bill in the zoning office. And I can be, again, available for questions.
Great. Yep.
Did you decide to look at why we separate those pieces from the top of the island?
Yeah, I don't know, Bill, do you want to talk about that too? But
I guess the main thought was, as Ben was alluding to, a lot of the project, or not a lot, but since we created an agricultural
processing
plant, I guess we felt that should be somewhat separate from Lake Great Bends or something more traditional on the farm. So this is actually another structure processing egg products. So I guess we thought, so it takes, it would take, as Ben said, either a conditional use permit or an interim use permit, similar to what we went through with Riverview and the build plant, as well as Fresh and America's, is why you made that change for having to make a customer process.
They're going to have to be more defining you could look at a grain grinder to see the process and conditions. I guess what I'm asking is, I'm just hoping it's something that
It's pretty definitely the only one from milk plant that definition doesn't fit a grain lake. Somebody puts a grain lake up, whatever, that's part of your farming. That's where your corn or beans are going. And then you're not building another structure on another piece of land. The process it for a different use. And I know there was some discussion between the county attorney and the representative from Riverview prior to that period. And then it was determined that we need to go through that
height variance was the big question. But the reason you were getting the initial use permit was for the egg processing plant.
Bill, just one more follow-up on that too. There was some discussion of, you know, and still keeping a limit for that because it was recognized that, you know, egg processing facilities are likely going to have multiple employees and there's health and safety EMS type requirements and considerations. And that's why it would still be important to go through that variance process to make sure that those types of facets were covered in the safety plan for that variance request, whereas like a farming operation could have people up there, but it would be limited to that farming operation with that grain leg and that bin.
Any other comments?
We want to clarify this lot regulation. Really, what's changing?
Well, I guess as an example, if you wanted to split off a piece of property, just put some grain bins up, the way the ordinance is right now, you need to split off 2.5 acres. So that happens right behind.
It's really not for the farmstead.
Well, if you're going to have another site that's going to have a dwelling on it for a house, you're going to need 2.5 acres.
Well, that's what it was too before, right?
Yes, it was. But this is clarifying that, say you've got your farm sites there right now, you want to put a pole shed up, grain bin up, but you need some more land and you need to split off, say, simply 3/4 of an acre.
Okay.
Otherwise, the way I was reading the ordinance, you're going to need 2.5. And I thought it would be a good time to clean up some of this. And as Ben said, there will be a document on visa that indicate that that's not for another sewage dwelling or anything like that. So if I come and want to buy that in 5 years, I'm going to see on the deed that I can't build a house there because it's too small.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments on the board? Okay, I'll ask for a motion to approve the ordinance amendments to the county. Ask for a motion. Okay, motion to the second. Any discussion? Hearing none, the following question. All in favor, signify by saying aye. Aye. All those opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Who is the motion in second?
Thank you.